Okay, the next item of business is a debate in motion 278 in the name of Michael Matheson on addressing the climate emergency. And I would invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Michael Matheson to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're already seeing the impact of the global climate crisis here in Scotland. Warmer temperatures with more extreme weather events, rising sea levels and the subsequent impact on the health and prosperity of our society and economy. And this will only increase if temperatures continue to rise. It's estimated every degree of warming in Scotland will cost us 1% of our GDP, effectively eliminating the prospect of growing our economy. I want to lay the groundwork for the next 5 years of the Scottish Government's approach to tackling the climate crisis, to acknowledge what Scotland has achieved to date and the significant opportunities in delivering a green recovery and a fairer, more sustainable future. I want to be absolutely clear on the challenges the nation faces in achieving our goal and the critical decisions we must take together. Scotland has taken a world-leading, distinctive and ambitious approach to tackling the twin crises of climate change and ecological decline, putting in place legislation, targets and governance to reduce emissions, to build our climate resilience and protect our environment, and critically, doing so in a just and fair way. We recognise that climate change is not just an environmental and economic issue, but also an opportunity to drive greater social justice. This is why a just transition to net zero is enshrined in law, and we've put people at the heart of our international climate action. Scotland can be proud that we have already halved our greenhouse gas emissions since 1990. Indeed, as the UK Committee on Climate Change stated, and I quote, Scotland has decarbonised more quickly than any G20 economy since 2008. We have already shifted almost 100% of our electricity use to come from renewable sources, and our funding for energy efficiency has benefited over 150,000 households since 2013. Drivers in Scotland benefit from 25% more public charging points per person than England, and double the public access than in Wales and Northern Ireland, thanks to the £45 million we've invested to date in our electric vehicle infrastructure. And over the last 2 years, Scotland has created over 22,000 hectares of new woodland, approximately 80% of the UK woodland creation, with our forestry industries now supporting around 25,000 jobs and generating £1 billion for our economy every year. What is already clear, however, is that the second half of the journey to net zero will be far more challenging. We must now achieve in the next 10 years what it has taken over the last 30 years. This will be a decisive and defining decade for us all. Our climate change plan update puts Scotland on a pathway to meeting its world-leading targets over the next decade, bringing together nearly 150 policies to drive our delivery. It includes a bold and credible package of measures to reduce emissions, such as our commitment to reduce car kilometres by 20% by 2030, by encouraging more active travel and use of public transport, tied to the development of 20-minute neighbourhoods, which will allow people to access key services close to where they live. Alongside reducing our emissions to net zero, we must also, as a nation, build our resilience to the impacts of global climate change, which is already locked in. Our climate change adaptation programme sets out over 170 policies and proposals on how we are responding to the main climate risk for Scotland over the period to 2024. Our response to climate risk includes our ambitious 10-year programme for some £250 million of investment in peatland restoration, delivering co-benefits for climate change, biodiversity, flood management and water quality. Funding that has already helped to restore over 25,000 hectares of degraded Scottish peatland, an area almost the size of Edinburgh itself. The journey to net zero will transform every aspect of our lives, how we live, how we work, and how we travel. I want Scotland to seize the opportunity that becoming a net zero society presents, growing our economy and enhancing our natural environment so that we can improve the health and well-being for all of our society. We need to make sure that our transition is a just transition, that in responding to changing climate, that the journey is fair and creates a better future for everyone, regardless of where they live, what they do, and who they are. By capitalising on Scotland's strengths in energy, natural capital, innovation, and on skilled workforce, we can be at the forefront of growing global low-carbon markets in the future. Opening the applications for local authorities to come forward to develop the first Green Growth Accelerator projects today is one of the key steps we are taking to unlock additional investment from emission-reducing infrastructure that supports our transition. Supported this year by £1 million, the Green Growth Accelerator will speed up delivery of low-carbon infrastructure projects right across Scotland and provide extra resource and technical support to local authorities to get projects off the ground more quickly. And once fully opened, the programme will unlock £200 million of public sector investment to drive our transition to net zero. Recent Inward Investment Plan, which was published by the Scottish Government, identified energy transition and decarbonisation of transport as two areas of competitive strength here in Scotland. How we heat our homes is a perfect example. We estimate that some 24,000 jobs could be supported each year by the rollout of zero-emission heat. Scotland needs to quickly go from niche to rapid deployment of new heat technologies, doubling our installations year on year per annum. And I want to see green jobs and skills in a burgeoning clean heat sector, and greener and more efficient homes and workplaces right across Scotland. I'll give way to Mr Whittle.
Brian Whittle.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. You'll be aware, of course, in Glasgow, they're looking to deliver electric buses, quite a few of the electric buses, but it has been suggested that they will take up the same amount of energy as it would be to heat 10,000 homes. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what the Scottish Government plans are to develop the network to be able to deliver that kind of energy resource?
Cabinet Secretary.
General, so Mr Whittle raised a very good point. I visited the Caledonian Depot just last week for the launch of the installation of the charging points, and it's a programme that's been taken forward by three parties: the Scottish Government, First Bus and Scottish Energy Power Networks, in order to make sure we capitalise on the capacity within the network in order to support the transition to electric vehicles, similar to the programme we have in South Lanarkshire and also the programme that we now have in the West Highlands with SSE networks to capitalise on the capacity within the network. But it's a good point about making sure we have the infrastructure in place to support that going forward. Presiding Officer, on the issue of domestic heating, regulation plays a key part in unlocking that transformation. But while we maximise our efforts in devolved areas, we need the UK Government to take urgent decisions on the future of the gas network to unlock longer-term planning and delivery. And we also need a UK-wide approach to reforming our energy markets that puts consumers first, aligned with our shared objective of net zero. While Government and Parliament has a clear role to play in a just transition to net zero, decisions on how we ensure the benefits, as well as how the costs are equally distributed, must be taken here in Scotland. It's imperative that we use all the levers available to us, including regulation, such as the UK Emission Trading Scheme, and the financial incentives, such as that offered by the Scottish National Investment Bank and other business supports. But our ambition and the action that we take as a government will mean little if we do not bring people with us. In fact, the UK Committee on Climate Change estimate that more than 60% of the changes needed will require at least some element of individual or societal behaviour change. Many habits and behaviours are ingrained over long periods of time. So behaviour change and demand management alongside technological solutions will be required. Therefore, in meeting our targets and harnessing the opportunities, we need to ensure the decisions and changes benefit the many rather than the few. This requires collective leadership as well as cross-sectoral collaboration. We've seen in Scotland how unplanned structural change in the past have left intergenerational scarring and deprivation. The recent opportunities arising from the rapid economic growth, globalisation, digitalisation have left many behind, with the costs and the benefits of these shifts being unequally distributed, often leading to inequality being exacerbated. The scale of the economic and social transformation necessitated by our transition to a net zero society requires us to make sure that we tackle some of the persistent inequalities such as child and fuel poverty. This is what it means to deliver a just transition, maximising economic, environmental, societal opportunities while mitigating risk arising from vast system changes needs to be addressed. Then, officer, my mission, the Scottish Government's mission, and I would challenge this Parliament's mission, is to deliver lasting action towards our net zero future. This is of paramount importance as we move towards COP26 and as we seek to set the same levels of ambition and action as other global leaders. A mission which set out in our first 100 days in our commitments, alongside my own appointment and that of Richard Lochhead as Minister for Just Transition. Then, officer, the actions and the commitments I've set out here are just a small example of where this government has and will continue to lower emissions, support the creation of jobs and develop new skills while fostering a culture of innovation to lead us into a net zero future. Presiding officer, I look forward to working with colleagues right across this chamber to provide collective leadership and clear support for actions towards a greener future, delivered through a just transition to net zero emissions, both here and internationally. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Liam Kerr to speak to and move Amendment 278.2. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are few things as urgent as tackling the climate emergency and preventing its disastrous consequences for people all over the world. The motion, which we shall vote for, describes it as a critical priority, and I think it's correct to do so. Of course, both the UK and Scotland have some of the world's most ambitious climate change targets, but it's way beyond time to focus on delivery, and I know the Cabinet Secretary agrees with me on this. So, throughout the afternoon, my colleagues will cover specific areas around progress on the journey to net zero. Maurice Golden will talk about the long-awaited circular economy bill. Brian Whittle will talk of the role of the private sector in driving technological change. And Sharon Dowie, in her maiden speech, will look particularly at roads and associated emissions. For my part, I wish to explore three principal areas. Firstly, I was interested by the motion's specific reference to restore nature. This is laudable, but again, we must start delivering. The Cabinet Secretary talked about biodiversity, but in 2011, Scotland signed up to the 20 Aichi biodiversity targets. Now, when Nature Scot recently assessed Scotland against those 20 targets, it concluded insufficient progress had been made, and only 9 of the targets had been met in full. Now, in our manifesto, we committed to introducing a nature bill to strengthen environmental protections on land, in rivers and at sea. Now, this would include new nature corridors to allow species to move between habitats, a commitment to redevelop derelict sites in towns and cities into green spaces, the piloting of new highly protected marine areas, and increasing new tree planting to 18,000 hectares a year by 2024. Now, we are convinced that these ideas still hold true, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary will meet with me in short course to discuss bringing some, if not all, of these measures forward. Now, secondly, we know, for example, from the Friends of the Earth Scotland briefing that transport is the largest sector creating climate change emissions. We also know that there was increased car use across Scotland before the pandemic, up 7.7% over the 5 years to 2018-19. And this week, DfT figures suggest British traffic is now nearly at pre-pandemic levels, whilst public transport use remains around half to two-thirds. Yet, electric vehicles account for less than 6% of the 3 million licensed vehicles on Scotland's roads. And that was why I was pleased to see that central to the UK's industrial decarbonisation plan for a £12 billion green industrial revolution is more green transport. Presiding officer, I think we could be on the cusp of exponential growth in electric cars, but range anxiety, limited recharging networks and high purchase costs are holding this back. And that's why I agree with the Cabinet Secretary about increases in infrastructure and why we must accelerate the programme by ChargePlace Scotland to install a charging network. Now, I think that will be helped by Ofgem's announcement of £48 million of funding to support 23 projects, including more electric vehicle charge points, and also Shell's purchase of Ubitricity and BP's purchase of ChargeMaster to help, amongst other outcomes, integrate EV charging with existing forecourts. Now, in light of the Cabinet Secretary's comments on delivery, perhaps in closing, the Minister could set out her view on our manifesto promise to develop a new action plan to deliver a complete national charging infrastructure by 2025 and subsidise the installation of charging points in homes and workplaces. Now, staying with transport, on rail there is much to be done. Although it only accounts for 1.1% of emissions, I was pleased to see ScotRail reckon they're on track for net zero emissions by 2035. Now, part of that will be about electrification of the network, but given only 25% is currently electrified and there's been a cut of £33 million out of this year's rail infrastructure budget, that cannot be the whole solution. Part of it might be hydrogen trains. I'm very pleased at the progress of the Scottish Hydrogen Train project at Bowness, and I'll shortly look to present a paper to the Cabinet Secretary on the possibilities looking at hydrogen trains. These are all incremental changes where innovation, entrepreneurialism and collaborative working between public, private and academic sectors drive the changes we need to see. And of course, nowhere is this more apparent than in the energy sector. No one, least of all the industry itself, denies that there is an issue. Extracting oil and gas within UKCS is directly responsible for around 3.5% of the UK's greenhouse gas emissions. Yet the industry responds to that by setting targets to cut emissions by 50% by 2030. 10 out of 15 oil and gas majors had, by the end of 2020, announced net zero emissions pledges, backed by a 34% increase in CapEx investment in the energy transition. It is an industry proactively working with Aberdeen University to set up the Centre for Energy Transition. It is an industry making changes, such that a recent study by RGU concludes that 10 years from now, most of the UK's offshore energy jobs will be in the low-carbon energy industry. This, of course, is supported by the UK's commitment to a 40 gigawatt offshore wind target, which is projected to help unleash around £20 billion of private investment in renewable energy by 2030. This is all evidence of the motion's call for a commitment to working together, as is the UK government's transformative North Sea Transitions deal, which will invest up to £16 billion to reduce emissions and secure 40,000 jobs across the supply chain. Intervention. Gillian Martin.
I thank Liam Kerr very much for taking my intervention. Would he agree that Ofgem, at the moment they're about to have a review, should have net zero in their mission, which they currently don't have, in order to look at transmission charges?
Liam Kerr.
I think it's a very important point, actually, and I think that the more that agencies are coming forward and stating, yes, we need to be talking net zero, we need to be driving net zero, I think there's something there. I think it's a very reasonable intervention. Presiding officer, Lorna Slater was right earlier this week. I am worried about the Greens. Actually, like workers, families and businesses across the North East and Scotland, I'm terrified of the consequences of them ever getting near the levers of power with their knee-jerk, cliff-edge intentions. Because those workers heard Lorna Slater saying last year, it's her ambition to shut down the oil and gas sector within 2 to 5 years. despite oil and gas still supporting 100,000 jobs, providing three-quarters of the UK's energy needs and meeting 70% of demand last year. And members will recall the IPCC published a special report on global warming, on achieving global warming of 1.5% degrees in October 2018, which states carbon capture, utilisation and storage is an important tool for emissions reductions and meeting the Paris Agreement goal. SSE Thermal says it could capture 1.5 million tonnes of CO2 annually. I know from his answer to my written question yesterday, the Cabinet Secretary agrees. He says, a proven technology. The Committee on Climate Change describes CCUS as a necessity, not an option. But the Green Party's view, page 16 of their manifesto, says the party opposed public investment in carbon capture and storage as it is unproven. And members may have heard of the OGTC, which opened in 2017 with £180 million of support from both our governments. Their mission statement says our mission is to accelerate the oil and gas industry to a net zero future, developing and deploying technology to make the energy transition affordable, decarbonising hydrocarbons, unlock investment in carbon capture and storage, develop a low-carbon hydrogen economy and secure sustainable, high-skilled jobs. It's great stuff. The Green Party's view, page 17 of their manifesto, specifically singles out by name the OGTC to demand we don't support it. I'm in my last minute, Mr. Ruskell. Presiding officer, the Green Party's policy of absolute zero emissions is neither realistic, practical, nor in line with either UK or Scottish Government policy. They would put the economy of Scotland, and especially the North East, and our genuine net zero ambitions at risk. Presiding officer, there are several ways to approach the extraordinary challenges we face. Certain MSPs prefer the slash and, ironically, burn approach based on dogma and ideology, which is a surefire route to economic and social chaos. Or there is an ambitious, forward-thinking, collaborative approach in which the public, private and academic work together to address the greatest challenge that we face, to support and indeed lead innovation and technology here in Scotland to create a net zero economy, not destroy the existing one. If the Cabinet Secretary wants to take this option, he will find a willing partner in the Scottish Conservatives. We will support the motion today, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Monica Lennon to speak to and move Amendment 278.1. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Climate change and nature loss are undeniably the greatest global threats we face, so we therefore welcome this debate today. My first is Scottish Labour's Net Zero Energy and Transport spokesperson. Of course, on these benches, we will miss the passion, knowledge and dedication to the environmental movement that Claudia Beamish brought to her parliamentary work. She is a loss to this chamber. However, we know that Claudia's commitment to tackling the climate and nature crises will very much continue. And I'm also grateful to Sarah Boyack for her leadership on these vital issues. And I'm pleased that we'll be hearing from Sarah later on in the debate. And I look forward to hearing from my new colleague, Mercedes Villalba, making her first speech. And of course, wish all new members the very best. Scottish Labour will be supporting the motion at decision time. We fully share the concerns and ambitions to addressing the climate and biodiversity crises and strongly agree that we need a green recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic. And while our words and votes in this chamber do matter, our actions outside the chamber matter more. We need to act fast and we cannot afford any more missed opportunities. In a few months' time, the eyes of the world will fall on Scotland when we welcome the COP26 conference to Glasgow. This will be a crucial milestone, commencing the decade where Paris Agreement measures take effect, and where significant emissions cuts are required to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees. Scottish Labour would like the Scottish Government to lead by example, and we'll support every endeavour towards that. And we agree with SCIAF, who have made some really important points to think about ahead of COP, including that we must confront deep carbon inequality, because those who have done the least to cause climate crisis are suffering the most. So with the right action, Glasgow and indeed Scotland can help to put the world on the road to recovery that is green, just and fair. Excuse me a moment, I've got a dry throat, Presiding Officer. And that takes me to our amendment today. We do need action. That's why we've put a prioritising a circular economy bill into our amendment. According to Friends of the Earth, and colleagues will know this, a circular economy would save Scotland 11 million tonnes of carbon dioxide emissions by 2050, a quarter of our current total. The bill must include targets to reduce material footprint and carbon footprint, including emissions embedded in imported goods and services. And it won't surprise the Cabinet Secretary to hear me raise the issue of incinerators, because we've had this discussion earlier today in the Chamber. New incinerators built now will lock us into years of wasting resources by burning them instead of reducing, reusing and recycling. And in a members' debate in the last Parliament, I urged the Government not to turn us into an ash heap nation. Worryingly, large-scale incinerators continue to be proposed in my region and across Scotland. In central Scotland, the Dovesdale Action Group have campaigned tirelessly, and whilst the commitment into a review of the role of incineration in the waste hierarchy is welcome, without a moratorium on building new incinerators, it will simply be too late. Now, we can all take action. I was coming to mention Maurice Golden, but I will give way.
Maurice Golden.
Member for taking an intervention. Does the member agree with me that it's an absolute disgrace that 30,000 tonnes of recycled waste were sent to be burnt last year in Scotland?
Monica Lennon.
I do agree, it's horrifying, and whilst we can all do more to tackle our throwaway culture, we do need big system change, and that's why regulation is so important. I will confess that I may have lobbied Maurice Golden to set up a cross-party group on circular economy, and now the whole Parliament knows, and if anyone wants to volunteer to be the Secretariat, get in touch with myself or Maurice Golden. On the issue though of that throwaway culture, you know, we all need faster action, including on fast fashion. I want to name check a business in my area in North Lanarkshire called Bag the Dress, and they specialise in selling pre-loved occasion wear, bridal dresses and so on. And it's really, really interesting, but we all need to do more to encourage lifestyle changes, but to get that big system change that Maurice Golden has talked about. And with COP26 just around the corner, again, Scotland can lead the way in tackling the pollution and waste created by the fashion and textile industry, and we all want to see progress on a bill. Last week, I had the pleasure of attending the launch of the Environmental Rights Centre for Scotland, and one of the guest speakers was the UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights and Environment, Professor David Boyd. And he was really interesting, but the real stars of the event were the young people from the Children's Parliament. And looking back, you can see that tackling climate crisis has been a key issue for the Children's Parliament since its inception 25 years ago, beginning with the Eco City project. More recently, their investigation for the Climate Assembly. And some of their ideas are just brilliant and so simple to implement, like a National Tree Planting Day, which is close to my heart as the Oak Champion in the last parliamentary session, to banning plastic packaging and single-use plastics. I've also met with young campaigners from Teach the Future, and they are fighting for climate justice. Their research and passion has convinced me that we need to embed climate justice within the heart of the curriculum. That is why, also in our amendment today, we are asking the Government and indeed Parliament to agree to this, because whilst progress has been made, and I do recognise that on the part of the Government, there is more that we need to do to embed climate education into our classrooms, and that is a cause that should unite all of us. And beyond embedding climate justice in education for our young people, we must embed climate solutions into people's everyday lives, and a joined up approach across government and across business and across all of society. We need greater investment in public transport and active travel to reduce emissions. And we cannot allow rhetoric to triumph over reality. In my area, the loss of the X1 bus, a crucial link between Hamilton and Glasgow, has been devastating. And I would welcome a meeting with the Transport Minister on this, if he could find the time. More broadly, the STUC are right when they talk about the need for a people's recovery and investment in a Green New Deal. We need serious investment in infrastructure, and renewable technology.
Could I ask the member to bring her remarks to a close, please?
Of course. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, there will be lots that we agree on today. I hope that this chamber will support our amendment, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Ms Lennon. I now call on Mark Ruscoe to speak to and move Amendment 278.3. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think, like so many people across Scotland, around the world, I've been deeply inspired and moved by the school climate strikes. And I do feel ashamed, particularly as a father, by the burden that we're set to leave on future generations. But at the same time, I'm really hopeful and positive that a greener, fairer future is possible. And I think we have all the tools in the box to tackle the climate and nature emergencies. We just need the political will to break from business as usual and drive that transformational change. And I think it's fair to say that, you know, so far we've enjoyed a fairly leisurely pace of change. An early retirement of coal-fired power stations, a first wave of onshore wind development, recycling of household waste. These have all helped to halve emissions over the last 30 years. But halving them again in the next 9 years demands an absolute step change, and tokenism just won't deliver. System change, deep system change will be needed to tackle climate change. And I think it's a real test for this Parliament, for our committees and the political culture that we create here. It will mean making hard decisions that will not please everyone in the short term. But it is about seeing those decisions through and making the transition work so that no one is left behind. And it will mean sharing thinking and ownership of the solutions and taking some political risks. And that's a challenge for everyone and every party in this chamber, including the Greens. So looking at the climate change plan, which is our only real route map to net zero in this Parliament, there are major challenges in there. We all know, for example, that the 20% reduction in vehicle mileage target is attempting to reverse a trend of traffic growth that has been relentless for the best part of 70 years. And like many people in this chamber, you know, I grew up with access to a family car and I benefited from it, as have my children. But our overdependence on the private car is not only killing the planet, it's ruining our health and well-being. It's dominating the public space needed for economic regeneration in our towns, while excluding many people because of their age, disability, or income. And so a target like that, I'm pushed for time actually with opening. I've got 4 minutes, Mr. Kerr, but I'll come back to you later on. A target like that won't be met without transformative change and investment. And if we want our towns to move and feel like Copenhagen, then we're going to have to act now and make non-essential car use a harder choice than public transport, walking, cycling, and wheeling. And likewise, if we want communities reconnected to the rail network and get freight off the roads and onto rail, that means diverting a big chunk of trunk road capital spending into that priority. Now, we will at times disagree on more challenging ideas like workplace parking levies, but if the solutions are rejected by parties in this chamber, then there's also a responsibility on those parties to put forward better solutions rather than backing a status quo, which is now completely untenable. And the Green Amendment mentions the 166 improvements to the climate change plan called for by four committees of the last Parliament just a couple of months ago. A remarkable level of cross-party consensus at a time when we've needed ideas and action like never before. It is the responsibility of this new administration to respond meaningfully to that will of Parliament and bring forward a revised climate plan as early as it possibly can in this session. Because time is not running out, Deputy Presiding Officer, it has already run out. Urgency, drive, innovation and a can-do attitude from all of us is needed, and it has to start today. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Ruscoe. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton to speak to and move Amendment 278.4.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful for the chance to speak in what I hope will be a genuinely constructive debate today. As the government motion sets out, tackling the climate emergency must be a shared and national endeavour, and that's why Scottish Liberal Democrats are proud of the part we have played in working with others to force the pace of change so far. Our 2030 target for 75% reduction in emissions, which Scottish Liberal Democrats supported and worked hard to secure with others, is one of the most determined in the entire world. And experts recognise that those targets push us to the very brink of what is possible. Chris Stark, the chief executive of the UK Committee on Climate Change, recently described it as very, very stretching. Now the work of making that target a reality really needs to bite, because more warm words will just make for an even warmer planet, and the measure of our commitment will not be ascertained in the ambition of the targets that we set, but in the rate and reach of their achievement. And my amendment today speaks to the very specific challenges presented by the transport sector, and that is what I intend to spend much of my time discussing, because we don't have a chance of meeting our climate change targets unless options for transport are truly, rapidly and radically decarbonised. And the First Minister said that she recognised this in her reshuffle and arranged the portfolios accordingly, and I welcome that. In 2015, transport became Scotland's single largest source of greenhouse gas emissions. It accounts for more than a third of all of our emissions. Progress has been made in other sectors, but transport hasn't budged. Presiding Officer, if that doesn't change, we are in trouble. And that has to be one of the main missions of this Parliament, because car travel has been on the increase since the end of World War II. In 2019, 48.7 billion vehicle kilometres were travelled by road. That's up 10% in a decade. And the pandemic means that people are understandably nervous about getting back into the groove of using public transport. And surveys have already shown that people are even more inclined to favour their cars above other forms of travel. So getting people out of their cars is one of our biggest challenges. On active travel, let's not shy away from the issue as it stands. We have failed to make Scotland a cycling nation. Now, my critics will point to the fact that I personally helped to lead a campaign that forced the City of Edinburgh to shelve plans for a low-traffic neighbourhood in my constituency. That is entirely true. But, Presiding Officer, I opposed that scheme, not because I oppose active travel. I do not, far from it. I opposed it because, had the City bothered to ask my community, they would have discovered they were closing routes into an area that was largely low traffic to begin with, and by so doing would actually compound congestion and pollution on arterial routes. Presiding Officer, I passionately support the principle of LTMs. I like what they've achieved in Waltham Forest, but I particularly like the 5 public consultations and co-production that went into its creation, none of which took place in my constituency, which is a great shame, because this council knows best approach to strong-arm constituents into permanent lifestyle change has certainly set back the active travel agenda in our city. It is typical of a disconnect between political aspiration and delivery on the ground. The 10% target for 2020 completely failed to materialise, and last September statistics showed that the share of car journeys taken by bike was actually falling to 1.2%. Put simply, cycling needs to be made as easy as possible. Lockdown showed that when people feel that cycling is a safer option, they are eager to take it up with quieter roads. Whole families were taking the opportunity to get out and to get active in a safe and sustainable way. And the streets of Amsterdam, Presiding Officer, were not filled with bikes by accident. Their governments gave them the infrastructure and the support they needed so that people, young and old, could feel safe and secure and comfortable enough to get on their bikes. There are so many things we could do here in Scotland to help people feel exactly like that. We could help planning processes to make sure that roads have the space for everyone to be kept safe, make funding available for facilities like showers and changing rooms in workplaces, and get cycling proficiency in schools back on track. At the moment, its availability is plummeting, and that makes no sense at all. And for the journeys where active travel isn't an option, electrification must be the way forward. But again, confidence is going to be key. Half of people say they would consider buying an electrical vehicle if they felt that the charging network was there to support them. We want to help them along the way by switching over council vehicles, police cars and the rest of the public sector. That would help motivate the charging network, roll out and build people's confidence so they can make that switch. Presiding Officer, my amendment signs off with a challenge. Heathrow is already the single biggest producer of emissions in the whole of the UK. A third runway would go directly against all of our green ambitions. The flights that would come to Scotland alone as a result would release 600,000 tonnes of emissions into our environment. Despite that, the SNP has a contract to support the building of that third runway, and that flies in the face of the climate emergency and everything we are trying to achieve. I'm afraid I'm in my last minute. Despite that, the SNP, so when the First Minister stood in this Parliament and declared a climate emergency, we were told that difficult decisions would have to be made, that everything would now be under review. Everything, it seems, except for that contract. Presiding Officer, that cannot be allowed to stand. And as such, I urge all of the colleagues in this chamber to support my amendment, and I move it in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call on Fiona Hislop to participate in the debate. Fiona Hislop, thank you.
Presiding Officer, I welcome the Cabinet Secretary to his new role. Of course, climate emergency issues need to run through every portfolio as a central backbone. And I agree a green recovery must embed just transition, and the Just Transition Commission needs to be central to our work. And I agree that biodiversity crisis needs to be addressed alongside the climate emergency. And I would like to pay tribute to Rosanna Cunningham for her work on the Edinburgh Declaration, and to Rosanna Cunningham and Stuart Stevenson for their previous leadership on climate change. We all need to constantly challenge ourselves. What more can we do? How faster can we go to make an impact? Presiding Officer, it's 14 years since I made a speech in this chamber as a backbencher, and I want to reflect on my own Linlithgow constituency, but also to reflect on some of the global and national issues. Presiding Officer, we need shared ambition, we need constructive accountability, and we need an attitude that we are all leaders in this mission. Internationally, global political leadership can no longer put off, abrogate, or dilute action or responsibility. Cultural climate diplomacy matters, and the virtual miles of the UK government need to be delivering now as host of the COP26 if the November summit, only months away, is to be effective. The US is increasing ownership of that global role, maybe a welcome reflection of their new president, but I hope it is not about filling of any vacuum. COP26, yes, is a showcase that Scotland must use as a demonstrator of our capabilities. But at the end of the day, it has to be about binding decisions between state governments to produce action. Nationally, this Parliament set out our ambitions on carbon reduction, and it did so collectively. Scotland's targets may be extremely challenging, but all parties support them, so we bear collective responsibility. And I warn that there will be difficult decisions to be made to deliver these targets. A knee-jerk opposition cherry-picking decisions we do not like must and will be called out. But we can come together to support the Scottish Government Circular Economy Bill and the £1 billion National Infrastructure Plan to catalyse emission reductions and the Green Accelerator announced today. We have public bodies, all of whom must contribute. We have a Scottish National Investment Bank capitalised with £2 billion of investment with a net zero core mission. Historic Environment Scotland is a world initiator, driving change along with California on the science, the technology and skills needed in that sector, and founding the Global Climate Heritage Network. And turning to community and constituency, many of my constituents pre-pandemic used car commute to Edinburgh and Glasgow. And with hybrid working, 25-minute neighbourhoods, cycle, park and ride, and the new planned Winchburgh rail station, we can deliver a step change in commuter emissions. The community in Linlithgow town has driven practical change, selling two community bonds funded by local people, providing ethical investment for local sports clubs, organisations and businesses to deliver local community energy, including solar panels. It provides better interest than banks, helps invest in local community energy, helps clubs save money, and also created a surplus. This is scalable. The Linlithgow Community Development Trust are making sure that they're building on the work of the community groups and churches throughout the pandemic, and building on many of the successful transition initiatives to develop new climate action. and I support their belief that communities need to be empowered and funded directly to be able to run local energy schemes to make that systemic shift of change happen. So this is a whole town approach, and there is an aim to be the first net zero town in Scotland. And I would ask the Minister, Mary McCallum, in closing, if she would consider accepting an invitation to visit my constituency to hear about the developments in Linlithgow to date and the plans for the future. Locally, many of my constituents work in Mitsubishi, who employ over 1,000 people producing commercial heat pumps. That technology use in housing retrofits will develop skills, growing jobs. And turning to other business, digital innovation and technology are key. And I am a keen supporter of hydrogen, and we need to not only research and pilot, but to implement and develop supply chains with the government's 100 million fund and follow up on the positive German and other international interests. On industry, we cannot and must not offshore trading emissions, and the careful industrial balance to prevent this will be key. And renewable energy transmission costs in Scotland are punitive, prohibitive, and they must be changed. And we need sectoral approaches. Food and drink, tourism are examples of sectors with serious plans already delivering, and culture has much to offer. And on construction, the greenest building is one which is already built. When you look at energy involved in aggregates and extractions and transportation, and a simple quick measure of that reduction for construction work from UK government on existing buildings to match that of new is a simple and rapid measure. I'm also pleased to see that the built environment is being prioritised in the Scottish Government's draft heat and building strategy and must be in the Green Skills Academy along with energy. And on finance, our business minister yesterday virtually welcomed 3,000 delegates from 100 plus countries to the Global Ethical Finance Summit as a staging post to COP26. So, Presiding Officer, with shared ambition, sharing responsibility, constructive accountability to support and drive change, and an attitude that we are all leaders in this place, we can serve constituency, community and country, and we might have a fighting chance to help save humanity internationally from itself and make an impact.
Thank you. I call next Sharon Dowie, who is making her first speech to our Parliament today, to be followed by Gillian Martin. Thank you, Ms Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to start by thanking each and every person who voted for the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party in the south of Scotland and to all those who helped me in my campaign. I would also like to pay tribute to John Scott. John Scott served in this place for 21 years. He has helped thousands of constituents and made a huge difference in his community. I would like to thank him personally for all his encouragement, wish him well, and hope that he can now enjoy a well-earned rest and spend more time with his wife Sheila and their family. I am not a career politician. I'm a lassie from Maybole. I've worked since I was 14, the last 35 years in retail. I entered politics because I want to make a difference. I have the honour and privilege of being able to represent the area where I was born and grew up, Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley, and also the area that is now my home, Ayr. I feel lucky to live in one of the most beautiful and diverse parts of Scotland. Other members may have said this of their areas, but I intend to use my time here to change their mind. Presiding Officer, I was born in Girvan, now famous for its palace, the Gin Palace, that is, at Grant's Distillery, the home of Hendrick's Gin and Grant's Whisky, amongst others. For those wanting a taste of Ayrshire, though, we can offer more than gin. The southwest of Scotland has the potential to be a premier tourist destination within the UK. Robert Burns, Clane Castle, Dumfries House, Heads of Ayr Farm Park, Craig Tara, Dark Skies, superb golf courses, including Turnberry, where the golf course is even more famous than its celebrity owner. And not forgetting the main route to the port of Cairn Ryan, the link to Ireland. We boast nationally and internationally renowned businesses. Nestle, McCulloch Rail and Ballantrae, Beggs and Eyre, Emergency One, EGA, and the many aerospace companies at Prestwick. We have colleges, a university, an airport, and a talented local workforce. But with all this in our favour, we are being left behind by a lack of investment in this forgotten corner of Scotland. 27% of children in Ayrshire live in poverty, compared to 23% in Scotland as a whole, while unemployment rates for 18 to 24-year-olds are 12.8% compared to 8.3% nationally. Last week, as I listened to speeches from other members, I was encouraged to hear Kate Forbes say, "We know that to achieve a successful recovery, we must ensure that no one is left behind." Well, Presiding Officer, it's time for the Scottish Government to put its money where its mouth is. Ayrshire is being left behind, and I challenge this Scottish Government to change that. The Ayrshire Growth Deal, a collaboration between the UK Government, the Scottish Government and the three Ayrshire councils, will bring a much-needed boost, but investment barely goes further south than Prestwick Airport. To encourage investment and growth further south, we badly need investment in our infrastructure. Dualling of the A77 is a priority. Currently, there is no plan of where this would be routed, let alone funded. The A70 is also badly in need of an upgrade, dealing with traffic en route to the port of Cairnryan. South Ayrshire would be in a prime position for a free port if we were not being let down so badly by the poor quality of local roads. On top of all this, countless people have been affected by unnecessary crashes that regularly occur on these two roads, while emissions continue to blight town centres like Girvan. This brings to mind comments from Fergus Ewing last week. He noted that one key element of a vibrant economy is good, safe and reliable transport links. He went on to say, "It may not be widely known, but the risk of serious head-on collisions is far greater on non-dual roads because there is no crash barrier, and we are not anti-roads, we are anti-emissions." This was echoed by the Minister for Trade, Ivan McKee, who said, "I will ensure that my colleague, the Minister for Transport, takes on board this point about the dualling of transport links." Of course, I am delighted that we have achieved cross-party consensus so soon, and I look forward to sitting down with the Scottish Government at the nearest opportunity to discuss their plans to upgrade South Ayrshire's roads. In this debate about addressing the climate emergency, I cannot finish without also mentioning the environmental ticking time bomb that is Terbolton Moss landfill site, a site that was closed 3 years ago and reportedly since been seeping pollution and gases into the environment. A situation that SEPA and the Scottish Government are well aware of, yet we are still waiting for action to be taken. With the recent report on the quality of bathing water at Ayr Beach, questions need to be raised as to whether the two are connected. In a new study on the dirtiest water at the UK's beaches, 7 out of the top 10 were in Scotland, with 3 being in South Ayrshire. It's simply not good enough. From someone who has just started in this place, I am full of enthusiasm and look forward to making a difference in all of our communities. We have a responsibility in this chamber to lead by example. We have a right to know the truth, and the statements and answers we hear should reflect that. And so, Presiding Officer, to conclude, I have 3 asks. Stop hiding and delaying reports to this chamber, and start using the knowledge and expertise in this place to fix them. Stop talking about what you're going to do and start delivering. And stop the division and start rebuilding. Thank you.
Thank you. And could I now call Julian Martin to be followed by Mercedes Vialba, and it will be Mercedes Vialba's first speech to our Parliament. Julian Martin, thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. So we all know what the targets are. Now we need the action and the system change to deliver on them. There's a lot to cover in the motion, but I want to specifically concentrate on one element of it, and that is just transition. I've spoken many times in this chamber on this issue, as it's affecting my constituents right now. A just transition is essential for people who work in high-carbon industries, and in Aberdeenshire's case, that is those working directly in oil and gas, and the people who rely on the supply chain for their living. It's also the economic health of the communities those workers live in who will be adversely impacted if this isn't done right. Over the past couple of years, I've lost count of the amount of friends and neighbours who are unsuccessfully trying to exit the oil and gas sector with a view to working in the renewable energy sector in particular. And we're talking highly skilled and experienced people here.
One of my friends, who I won't name, is a former project manager in the drilling sector, and he couldn't even secure a delivery driver job once he lost his job. And he's now gone to work in the Middle East without his family with him out of sheer necessity. Off the back of hearing this anecdotal evidence of difficulty, once re-elected, I launched a survey for oil and gas workers to get on record their experiences of transitioning. And I've had a quite incredible response. The survey will remain open during the summer to give people time to complete it. And as many in this chamber will know, because I have mentioned it quite a few times, my parents moved from Clydebank in the 1970s to Aberdeenshire because there wasn't a just transition for those working in heavy engineering. And it's fair to say that they were the lucky ones. Moving gave my dad a new career in oil and gas and a secure future for their family. But many of his friends in Clydebank never worked again, and some of them even moved to Canada to avoid unemployment. And we cannot have a repeat of what happened to Scottish mining, steel and shipbuilding communities in the 1980s. But it just isn't enough to say so. We need to urgently find out what the issues are and how to work with the sectors to address them as quickly as possible. The funding for the North East delivered by my colleague Fiona Hislop last year is hugely welcome, as is Young Persons Guarantee and Green Jobs Fund, but there are other structural and regulatory difficulties that really need looked at, although not all of them are directly in the hands of the Scottish Government. I will.
Liam Kerr.
In our comments today. 11 years ago, the SNP predicted that there would be 28,000 jobs in offshore wind by 2020, but I think there are only 1,400 today. Is the member able to detail any actions being taken that would reassure the workforce she is rightly flagging?
Julian Martin.
I'm glad that Liam Kerr mentioned that, because it actually swings back to the intervention that I made on him, because one of the reasons I think that there aren't the same amount of jobs that we predicted is a regulatory issue. One issue that comes up time and time again is the amount of jobs in renewables. Liam Kerr has led beautifully onto that part of my speech. Last week, I put a topical question in on one of those blockers, fulfilling our potential in renewables. It wasn't chosen, so I'll reference it now, and maybe the Minister might want to pick up on it in their closing remarks. A report by Renewable UK highlights that the transmission charges for Scotland's electricity are dramatically higher compared to others in the UK market, specifically south of England. And power generators located in the north of Scotland pay 16 times more for using the transmission system compared to many EU countries that are exporting electricity into our grid. So I want to ask, might our homegrown renewable sector potential be limited because of these unfair charges? And what is the job potential that we're losing out on? As I said in my intervention to Liam Kerr, Ofgem has recently indicated that it's considering a full review of locational charging within the significant code review. However, Ofgem isn't currently required to regulate for the delivery of net zero, and therefore it has no legal basis for making changes to the charging regime to reflect this policy objective and to make electricity from renewables more competitive. And I think that actually the majority of people in Scotland would actually like to have their electricity coming from renewables. I'd like the Minister to maybe outline what representations that have been made to the UK Government on these points and to Ofgem. I'm going to use the rest of my time to deliver direct quotes from some of the respondents to my survey as a little bit of a teaser for when we actually put it into a report. And they'll pinpoint other things that really need addressing as we put just transition and green jobs plans into place. A female chemical engineer of 10 years' experience in oil and gas said this: "There should be an accessible framework that allows people to clearly see where their core skills can be transferred into existing roles within the renewable sector. Tangible pathways to identify a route and role destination in the renewable sector is essential." A male oil and gas worker with 21 years' experience said, "I have been made redundant and cannot find full-time work. The cost of global wind organisation certificates is prohibitive." And a male oil and gas worker with over 30 years' experience said this: "Transfer the skills and stop having to train to do APITO, GWO and STCW, as the courses are basically the same. Just amalgamate them. This would save out-of-work people a huge amount of money." And a female engineer with over 20 years' experience said, Is there professional training that could be offered part-time in the evenings that oil and gas professionals like me could undertake while still in employment? This would encourage my active transition instead of waiting until I'm made redundant and have no choice. So I look forward to formalising more of the testimony these people have provided with in a report in late summer, which I will send to the Cabinet Secretary and to industry bodies. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Mercedes Villalba. This is Ms Villalba's first speech in the Chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and congratulations on your role. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in today's debate on the climate emergency because it's an issue that I care deeply about and which is especially relevant to the people in the North East. The North East, of course, is where I was elected to represent by people who entrusted Scottish Labour with their vote. And I stood for Scottish Labour because Labour in Parliament are the political wing of the wider Labour movement. And that's important because workers in my region and in the rest of Scotland need parliamentarians who will be on their side and who will fight for them and who will fight for the planet. I make this link between people and planet because tackling the climate emergency and improving workers' rights go hand in hand, because climate justice is inextricably linked to economic and social justice. There are two fundamental challenges facing us: the class inequality that still blights our society and smothers the potential of millions, and the climate emergency that threatens life on Earth. For too many, work is defined by low pay, 0 hours contracts and unsafe conditions, all in order to maximise profits for those who already have more than enough. And at the same time, those at the top are fueling climate catastrophe by destroying habitats, polluting our air and poisoning our oceans. The root cause of both insecure, low-paying work and disasters like the pandemic is our economy. The capitalist system has consistently prioritised short-term profit over long-term sustainability and quality of life. Why are people homeless while properties lie empty? Because it makes someone money. Why are people forced to choose between heating and eating, even though we have ample food and limitless potential for renewable energy? Because it makes someone money. And why are people in poorer countries priced out of life-saving vaccines? Because it makes someone money. Because it makes someone money, and because for too long governments have been enthralled to the idea that privatisation leads to better services. So climate change, public health and unemployment are all intrinsically linked by our economic system. And this has done great damage to our society and to our planet. But the great opportunity we have is that we can tackle both by implementing a socialist Green New Deal with democratic public ownership at its heart. Energy, water, transport, mail and telecommunications, these are natural monopolies that should serve the people, not profit. But more than this, they're also our tools in the work of building a healthy society and planet. We're going to need to retrofit our homes to reduce carbon emissions and end fuel poverty. That means job creation. We'll need electrified and expanded public transport to boost our city centres, connect communities and reduce car use and pollution. That means job creation. And we'll need to green our public spaces, creating active travel routes, biodiverse green corridors and accessible parks. That means job creation. But not just any jobs. We must strengthen trade unions and promote worker ownership so that when we create these jobs, we build an economy that's resilient and fair for all. We can do this by ensuring a just transition from carbon-intensive sectors through a streamlined retraining programme and the guarantee of unionised pay. And by using public procurement to promote decarbonisation, restore the environment and guarantee fair work at home and further afield through international supply chains. Because our Green New Deal must be global. And unless we cancel debt and freely share technology and resources, we condemn those least responsible for climate change to bear the brunt of its effects. And if the pandemic has taught us one thing, it's that we're all connected. A pandemic that began thousands of miles away has wreaked havoc on society right here. So the choices we make in Scotland on our environment and our economy are equally momentous. So we must choose a sustainable and fair economy. We must choose to empower workers, and we must choose to create a society that values people and planet over profit. We must do so because, in the end, there really is no other choice. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Lorna Slater to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I am keen on cooperative and consensus-building politics, I was very pleased to read a copy of the Cross-Party Committee recommendations on tackling the climate emergency that was produced during the last session of Parliament. These are the 166 recommendations mentioned in Mark Ruskell's amendment. These represent 166 actions that this Parliament has already agreed are necessary to tackle the climate crisis and can be the basis for a credible pathway to meeting the ambitious targets that have been set by this Parliament. Targets are all very well, but now let us have action. A report from the International Energy Agency last month said that for global temperatures to stay within 1.5 degrees Celsius, there must be no new investment in fossil fuel projects. However, the UK Tory government has refused to rule out new licences for additional exploration and production of oil and gas in the North Sea. According to a survey out yesterday, barely one in four, only 27% of people support this. Most people in the UK, 63%, want the UK government to switch billions of pounds of public money away from North Sea oil and gas and fund low-carbon industries instead. As I mentioned last week, I am deeply sceptical of the UK's North Sea transition deal because the entire premise of it is that the UK government intends to give yet more money to oil and gas companies to allow them to extract and burn yet more fossil fuels in the hope that they can invent and implement new carbon capture technologies fast enough to still meet our climate targets. They can't. It isn't possible. It's a fantasy. Carbon capture is needed to absorb out of the atmosphere the carbon that's already in it. It isn't a free pass to keep burning this stuff. It's needed to keep us from reaching 3.5 degrees of global warming. We need to use the time we have and the resources we have. Sorry, go ahead.
Liam Kerr.
In your manifesto, so I'd be interested to hear the member talk about that. But does the member still wish to shut down the oil and gas industry within the next, what would be, 4 years?
Lorna Slater.
I'm delighted, you'll be delighted, that the entire manifesto was written by the party and is represented by the party and isn't up to me to say. So we will be going with what's in the manifesto, you'll be delighted to hear. According to the survey, almost two-thirds of Scots support the creation of a concrete plan to wind down the existing extraction of oil and gas in the North Sea and other waters around the UK. So the approach to wind down the industry has wide public support. I'm more than happy to talk about a specific timeline that would make the member happy. Fortunately, within these 166 cross-party recommendations from the last session of Parliament, there is plenty of good news that I see on jobs, which I know is of concern to the Scottish Conservatives in particular when it comes to the North Sea. Among the recommendations are proactively considering future workforce needs and supporting people into green jobs, collecting better data to monitor trends in jobs to ensure that this support goes where it's needed. There'll be a lot of jobs to be had in forestry and peatland restoration if we invest in those things. I see that there is cross-party support for funding, for retraining and jobs guarantees for young people. We, of course, would like to see a jobs guarantee for oil and gas workers as well. And I see lots of support for the growing rural talent initiative for rural jobs. I see recommendations for investing in the Green Jobs Fund and more. And these are things we've already agreed on. This is a great start. Let's do the work to join up these practical recommendations to create the jobs we need to both recover from the pandemic and allow a planned phase out of oil and gas extraction.
Thank you. I call Emma Harper to be followed by Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Worldwide, we are in the midst of a climate and biodiversity emergency. And it is the actions of leaders across the world in the next 5 years that will determine the future of our world for future generations. We know the science is real. climate change is real and human activities are the main cause. Scientifically, we are now firmly in the Anthropocene, a period of unstable global warming where global temperature has risen by 1.1 degrees in the last 100 years. This temperature increase has caused immense damage, but it's not too late to act. I grew up watching Sir David Attenborough and have witnessed his shift to be more protectionist of our environment and biodiversity. At 95 years old, Sir David stated he just can't stand by, and I agree. And in his new TV show, he says, we're at a unique stage in our history. Never before have we had such an awareness of what we humans are doing to the planet. And never before have we had the power to do something about it. The future of humanity and indeed all of life on Earth now depends on us. These are powerful words from Sir David that we must all heed. What we have learned during the pandemic is that society is able to come together to take radical action for the common good. And as we head into recovery from COVID-19, we must keep that spirit alive to build a sustainable recovery. In Scotland, we're already delivering to address both the climate and biodiversity emergencies. In government, the SNP have been the first country in the world to declare a climate emergency and have since passed legislation for the world's most ambitious emissions reduction targets to bring us to net zero emissions by 2045. We've already halved our greenhouse gas emissions since 1990, and we are world renowned for having underpinned our net zero targets with a legislative commitment to a just transition, ensuring no one is left behind. We have committed to a green recovery from COVID-19 and announced £62 million investment in an energy transition fund. And we've been active on the world stage, leading the Edinburgh process on biodiversity and publishing the Edinburgh Declaration, calling for increased action to tackle biodiversity loss. Scotland is playing our part, but we must have an international approach and we must have a local approach which takes our communities and citizens with us on this vital journey. Presiding Officer, Scotland is leading the way in tree planting in the UK, with 82% of UK woodland being in Scotland. In 2019-20, we planted 11,050 hectares of new woodland, exceeding our annual 10,000 hectares target. This is extremely welcome. However, if we are to be truly serious about addressing the climate and biodiversity emergency, we will need to change land use as we currently understand it and focus on forest and woodland, peatland and renewable energy. I'm contacted by some constituencies who have concerns about proposed forestry, woodland and wind farm developments across the south of Scotland. These concerns range from the percentage of Sitka spruce compared to the percentage of native broadleaf species which are planted. And concerns are also raised over the visual impact of offshore and onshore wind farm development. I'm interested in pursuing thorough community engagement for offshore wind to be created if it brings good green jobs and much needed community benefit, especially to Wiltshire in my South Scotland region. I'm pleased to see the commitment from the government in the revised climate change plan to hold early engagement, consistent communication and genuine dialogue between different groups and communities. I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to outline how this engagement will be done and whether local authority planning frameworks will be changed to enable development given their urgent need. This government has funded the restoration of over 25,000 hectares of degraded Scottish peatland. Some of this funding has come directly to the Crichton Carbon Centre and the Galloway Fisheries Trust in Dumfries and Galloway, where peatland expert Dr Emily Taylor and the team are restoring over 17,000 hectares of peat in the River Luce catchment area. Important work, as peatlands are capable of absorbing and storing 50% more carbon than some of our trees. And when I visited a peatland restoration project with Dr Taylor at Kersgowan Moss near Wigtown, we measured the peat bog at 6 metres deep. This is good because deep peat is normally measured at 40 centimetres. And one issue that Dr Taylor raised with me was that there is currently no international agreed definition of deep peat. And given that peatlands have a proven ability to sequester carbon, I asked if the Cabinet Secretary could pursue an international agreed level of peat so that carbon sequestration can be calculated more efficiently. I welcome this debate and the progress being made on the climate and biodiversity crisis in Scotland, but I repeat the need for international cooperation and on bringing people with us on this journey. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Maurice Golden to be followed by Alex Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Parliament has agreed that we need to achieve net zero, but the last 5 years have seen the SNP government preside over a catalogue of failures to meet their own targets. We need a step change in approach if we are going to create a circular economy, improve biodiversity, and truly tackle climate change. Plastic pollution is a growing threat and one which risks accelerating climate change. If we don't change, there will be more plastic by weight in the seas than there are fish. Moreover, the light-absorbing properties of microplastics pose a risk to Arctic regions, potentially speeding up the melting of ice caps. Microplastics also contribute to biodiversity loss, weakening ecosystems, damaging economies and impacting human health. Either through ingesting contaminated seafood or through airborne particles, lowering the air quality in our towns and cities. And plastic pollution is right on our doorstep. Surveying Scottish waters between 2014 and 2020, Marine Scotland revealed a worrying picture. In five of the areas studied, concentrations of microplastics were comparable to the North Atlantic and North Pacific, areas of open ocean infamous for their vast rubbish patches. Some efforts have been made to tackle the problem, banning single-use plastics, such as small cosmetic beads, but these sorts of plastics account for just 2% of seaborne plastic pollution, according to research from the Galway Mayo Institute of Technology. Both the Marine Scotland and Galway Mayo studies found that it was fragments of larger plastic items causing the most pollution. In fact, tyres, road markings and synthetic fibres account for a staggering 70% of seaborne microplastics, according to the Galway Mayo research. We need to establish a plastic pollution baseline for Scotland with a dedicated survey vessel in place to properly inform future policies. We should launch a public awareness campaign to remind drivers to keep tyres properly inflated. This would reduce abrasion and thus reduce microplastic fragments. A simple measure, but this could have a long-lasting impact. But about one-third of plastic pollution is from textiles, yet the SNP cancelled Zero Waste Scotland's textiles programme and pulled out the Love Your Clothes campaign. Meanwhile, around 50% of textiles are still going to landfill in addition to causing sea pollution. Moreover, just 2% of our plastic waste is recycled here in Scotland. Yet the SNP have still not committed to a new plastic recycling facility or micro-recycling facilities and waste hubs for rural communities, all of which I have been calling for since 2017. The overall household recycling rate is now worse than 2016, and the SNP have still not met their 2013 household waste recycling target. And progress is really concerning in some key areas. Dundee's SNP Council recycles less than 35%, while the SNP in Glasgow cannot even manage 25%. What an absolute embarrassment. A stark contrast to areas where Conservatives are in power, such as Angus, which recycles almost 60% of its waste, and Perth and Kinross, which recycles 52.7%. Then there is disposal. The SNP failed to deliver their 2021 landfill ban on biodegradable waste, so they've decided to burn waste instead, with incineration capacity skyrocketing 400%. What a terrible message to send out as the world arrives in Scotland for COP26. For Scotland, the ashtray of Europe. Instead, we should be putting a moratorium on new incineration capacity, as my colleague Monica Lowne has mentioned. happy to.
Graham Simpson.
Thank you. It's on that very point. I think you've just made the point. If Maurice Golden was in the Cabinet Secretary's position, would he have given a firmer answer than Mr Matheson gave me earlier when I called for just that moratorium? Would Maurice Golden call for that immediately?
Maurice Golden.
Yes, I would. And if I had been in that position over the last 5 years, then actually I would have helped the SNP meet all their targets. But these issues can still be dealt with, Presiding Officer, with a circular economy bill promised before the pandemic, but which is now missing in action. Also missing is any serious deterrence to illegal waste dumping. Last year, there were also only 17 convictions in Scotland for fly tipping, an abysmal figure which makes a mockery of the law. Is it not time now to hand prosecution powers to SEPA? Added to all of these failures, we have a biodiversity crisis with 1 in 9 species threatened with extinction, yet the SNP haven't published a biodiversity strategy since 2013, and less than half of public bodies are failing to comply with the duty to publish reports on biodiversity compliance. The SNP's catalogue of inaction missed targets, including illegal emissions targets for the last 2 years, even reducing Zero Waste Scotland's operating budget, makes it difficult to believe they can deal with the growing problem of climate change. But to end on a consensual note, the SNP must now work across chamber with MSPs who have the knowledge and expertise to deliver our climate targets, create a circular economy and establish Scotland as a plastic neutral nation.
Thank you. I call Alex Rowley to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Presiding Officer. I note that, well, I should say last night I watched the one of my favourite TV programmes, Yes Minister, and Sir Humphrey said that the problem with politicians is they start to believe their own speeches. And as I look back at the amount of speeches that have been made in this Parliament on this subject, then, you know, we need to get past the speeches and have a really clear line of action across all the areas. And that's why I do welcome the Cabinet Secretary to his new post, because I think there is an opportunity there to try and make that happen. And in the interest of consensus today, my understanding is that the amendments that have all been put forward have been accepted. And if you look at those amendments, there are issues in there that we really should have tackled by now, not just the last 12, 14 years of an SNP government which has failed, but actually the failure since 1999 of successive governments to tackle some of these issues. I also noted the point that Michael Matheson made where he said that we needed to take people with us and build a movement of change, a movement that wants to tackle climate in this country and indeed across the world if we're going to succeed. But I would say that if you look at the amendments, so the Green Amendment from Mark Ruskell talks about housing policy. Now, we could have major investment in this country right now. We can invest in the housing infrastructure, and we should tackle. I just find it difficult to accept that there are over 24% of households in Scotland living in fuel poverty. There are some 12.4% of households that are living in extreme fuel poverty. Now, that's over 300,000 households in Scotland living in extreme poverty. And despite all the speeches that have been made in this place in the last 7 years that I've been here, those figures are incredible. So we could start to set out a very clear plan and bring forward the targets that have been put in place for fuel poverty. And if you link that, if we're talking about real people here, if you link that firstly to those that are in fuel poverty, it would be a massive boon for them not to be in fuel poverty. But if you then talk about joined up government, because the numbers of people living in fuel poverty will access our NHS services more because of their poor health, because of the dampness and the condensation and the conditions in which they're expected to live. The clear correlation between that is evidenced, it's factual. You then have the levels of inadequate housing, poor housing and private rented housing that's not up to standard. So there's one area immediately where we could start to tackle some of the issues we're talking about today, but also tackle some of the big problems that people are living with. The just transition that the government motion talks about, well, you know, I'm for Fife. I have seen the shipyards compete and compete and compete to try and get work, and we've seen jackets being transported halfway round the world while the yards sit empty. And even though I've welcomed the investment that has gone in, we need to see far more investment if we are truly going to take advantage and get the jobs that will come with a transition. And if it doesn't happen, then you won't take people with you. And if we end up a low-wage, low-skilled economy, then we will never take people with us. And that's the danger. Low-wage, low-skilled economy, or work to put the investment into research and development, work with the private sector as well as the public sector, and we will get the jobs that can come. The Liberal Democrat amendment talks about electric vehicle infrastructure. The truth is that it's fine for Michael Matheson to say we're doing better in England and Wales and Ireland, but the reality is we're actually still not doing that great. And there is mixed messages out there. In Fife, before the pandemic broke, they put forward a paper to a committee to introduce a whole range of charges for the electric transition. And it's the poorest people then that suffer again. Because if you lived up in the northeast of Fife, you'd be cheaper than them across and charging your car up in Dundee than you would be in Fife. But if you own your own car, your own house, your driveway, etc., you'll charge your car for your house. People like me who live in flats, that's a lot more difficult. And it is the poorer people normally that are living in those areas where they don't or are not able to just drive their car into their garden. So there are issues there. There are issues there. I don't know if anyone's went and looked at what electric cars actually cost, but there is a barrier there, again, a cost barrier. So if you're wealthy enough, you can run about in your electric car and do your bit for the environment. If you're poorer, you'll be priced out. And talking about being priced out, the cost of the buses, many of us in here probably never use buses, but you're quite amazed when you get on a bus and you actually see what it costs. The same with the trains. I have complained before when Michael Matheson was the Transport Minister that people can't afford to use the trains. So poorer people are paying the price. So if we're serious about taking people with us, then we need to start to look at all these issues. There is a lot we can do right now. We could have an ambitious programme for tackling some of the big issues in Scotland and at the same time working on the environment and taking people with us. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I call Claire Adamson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome Mr Matheson and Ms McCallum to their new roles this afternoon, and also congratulate Sharon Downey and Mercedes Villalba on their maiden speech, both of which were very passionate, and I look forward to working with them going forward. If I may say, it was also lovely to hear Ms Hislop able to concentrate on her local constituency and speak about some of the work that's going on there, and it reminded me of some of the things in my own constituency that I would tell to the Chamber and encourage them to visit too. So in my constituency we have the BRE Centre of Excellence for House Building, and there we have retrofitted houses showing how existing sort of Wheatley style houses can be adapted to be more energy efficient, as well as examples of energy efficient new build housing. And it's very interesting to visit. And also I have Greenhead Moss in my area, which is a former coal mine, now given over to a local park. And in that we have protected peatland. And also it's the home of the small peril border flotillary, of which I'm the species champion. So another champion in the room this afternoon. I would like to really this afternoon reflect on what I thought was going to be a very, very consensual debate. Almost to the last moment, Mr. Golden may have severed that a little for my feeling this afternoon, but it's, if I could just quote, "Oh, would some power the gift to give us to see ourselves as others see us?" Because we do become very insular in this place, but it's interesting to see what the world view is of what we're trying to achieve in Scotland at the moment. Indeed, at the United Nations Climate Action Summit in New York in 2019, the Executive Secretary and UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, Patricia Espinosa, said, congratulations, she actually put it in a tweet, congratulations Scotland, for demonstrating bold leadership on climate action. This is an inspiring example of the level of ambition we need globally to achieve the Paris Agreement. And we have globally the most ambitious legal framework for emission reduction. And while the targets indeed are challenging to us, not only as individuals, to our communities, as has been discussed this afternoon, and to the economy and our environment, the climate and biodiversity crisis must be a critical priority for all of us in this chamber. 75% reduction by 2030 and net zero by 2045. We have the policies to do this, and with the appointment of the first ever Minister for Justice Transition, we have the leadership to implement these policies. And if I could highlight just a few of them, investing £120 million in zero emission buses, driving forward decarbonised future for Scotland's bus fleet, a new £180 million emerging energy technologies fund to support development of hydrogen and carbon capture storage and add impetus to the development of negative emission technologies. And also a cashback scheme for householders, which will provide eligible households with access to up to £7,500 towards the cost of renewable heating systems and a further £6,000 for energy efficient measures. And it's these types of policies that are going to help us achieve those targets. Yes, certainly.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. I think on that point, the SNP's 2021 budget cut funding for zero waste, which encourages recycling and a move to a circular economy, by £4 million. How does she square that with the comments that she's just made?
Claire Adamson.
Well, I think in this term of the Parliament, we're going forward, we all signed up to the climate target agreements. It was unanimous in this place, and it's incumbent on us all to look forward to how we achieve this. So I want to look to the future and to the policies that are coming that will help us implement this. Younger people were talked about Mr. Ruskell and by many others, and Monica Lennon mentioned the Children's Parliament as well. And during the election, I was written to by some primary four pupils from Calder Bridge Primary in my constituency, and it was the concern for their futures. One pupil, all to do with the climate crisis as they saw it and the worries for the future. One pupil raised wildfires in Australia and the terrible impact on the wildlife there and on endangered species. Another was concerned about the destruction of the rainforest that could possibly lead to food shortages in the future. Another was concerned for litter in his own community and the wider impact of plastics in our oceans, as we mentioned by Mr. Golden. Another expressed concerns for bees and wildlife and then the impact of loss of habitat and also the use of insecticides. And one was just wondering if there would be polar bears when he grew up to be my age. And finally, one young lady said that having persuaded her parents to get her a puppy, she was sure that she could persuade adults that she knew to do the right thing in changing their behaviour and habits and to prevent damaging the environment. I have to tell Miss Lennon, I directed that young lady to the Children's Parliament, and I'm sure we'll see her in here one day in the future. From the mouth of babes, I was absolutely blown away by the knowledge, by the interpretation of these young people, and also the fact that they knew that this was all interlinked. And we've talked about so many of these things this afternoon, participatory planning for communities, the fact that our skills and our development has to meet the aspirations of what we're doing, and that's why I'm so delighted BRE works so closely with New College Lanarkshire and the skills that are needed for retrofitting and for the builds that they have on site. And for those young people to understand those threads that link everything, that build our environment and build the sustainability of our world going forward, I was absolutely blown away by their knowledge, their understanding. They get this. And as Mark Russell says, it's incumbent on us to do the right thing by them and ensure that we all live up to those targets that we all signed up to in the last session of the Parliament. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. We now move to closing speeches, and I call on Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Well, thank you very much, Deputy. It's not Deputy. I get that wrong every time. My apologies, Presiding Officer. This has been an excellent debate, I thought, and some first-class first speeches, both from Sharon Dowie and Mercedes Villalba. It's great to have you among us, and I look forward to your further contributions. And we've got so much to do. If nothing else, today's debate has shown us that. We need to plant millions of trees. We need to heat our home and all of our buildings without burning fossil fuels like we do at the moment. We should have whole towns running on renewables, ground source, air source heat pumps, district heating. We need to switch over millions of polluting cars to electric vehicles and get the charging networks in place to do that. And I thought Liam Kerr spoke very well on that topic. He also talked about the need for carbon capture and storage. And I absolutely agree. That is part of the solution. It works, but it is not a get out of jail free card, and it must be done in tandem with a radical overhaul of the way that we all live our lives. And he talked extensively about the quandary of the North East, and it is a quandary because we can't just pull the rug there or pull the plug there. We need a just transition, and Gillian Martin, I thought, was right to address that as well. Presiding Officer, we need to restore nature around us as a critical part of this endeavour and to recognise the inexorable link between the nature emergency and the climate emergency, because they are so deeply intertwined. And that's why I think that both the Cabinet Secretary and I think Lorna Slater both mentioned the need to restore our peatlands. Some members may know that in the last Parliament, I was the RSPB species champion for the rusty sphagnum bog moss. They called me the moss boss. The proliferation of bog moss is key to Scotland's efforts to reduce. You may laugh, but it is really key to reducing our emissions. Why? Because it grows on peat. And not only that, but it does so if it's sufficiently irrigated and is one of the best absorbers of CO2 that grows in Scotland. And when we dry peat, when we cut it, we release huge amounts of carbon into the atmosphere. That is why restoring our peatlands is so important, and I will continue to campaign for it, even if I am not the moss boss in this Parliament. Monica Lennon articulated very well, I thought, the need for us to deal with the waste products of the various industries that we have in our society, and that was the theme picked up also by Maurice Golden when he talked about addressing the problem of plastic pollution. And this is a massive problem. We need to get rid of all the single-use plastics, an estimated 300 million plastic straws, 276 million pieces of plastic cutlery, 50 million plastic plates, and 66 million polystyrene food containers are used annually in Scotland. At a beach clean in South Queensferry in my constituency, Presiding Officer, we pulled 174 single-use wet wipes off the beach, which had been flushed out and did not degrade in the seed. I'm sure that every person in this chamber felt the public will for change during the election. All parties were elected on promises for a greener and fairer future. And it is the fairer future that I thought that Mercedes Villalba really captured in what I thought was a spellbinding first speech. She reminded us of the substantial barrier to progress that profit creates in existing business practices. And she also reminded us that climate injustice and poverty are also inexorably linked. And Alex Rowley was right to say that it is easier to go green if you have money. Presiding Officer, from young people in particular, the message is clear. I'm really glad to see the work of the Teach the Future campaign being represented in the Labour amendment today, and my party are fully supporting that campaign as well. Young people have already had an incredible impact on the conversation around the climate emergency so far, and the school strikes of 2019 made a huge difference. Young people marched down the Royal Mile and knocked on this Parliament's door, and I was with them with my teenage son, Finn. The declaration of a climate emergency finally followed, along with our new emissions reductions targets. But we cannot only make progress when we have people knocking on the door of this place demanding it. Where sensible policies are implemented, real systemic change can happen. The plastic bag charge is one example of that. There needs to be more of that. There are also many promising policies in the realm of the circular economy alone. The deposit return scheme, something which the Scottish Liberal Democrats have long campaigned for. Likewise, a latte levy that would help people get back into the habit of taking their reusable cups with them. Because I'm very concerned that the strictures of the pandemic have caused us to lose our way on some of the progress that we've seen people taking in terms of reusable options already. Of course, these are all problems that we work when working together. And Mark Ruskell talked about cross-party consensus, and I've worked with Mark before. I look forward to working with him in this Parliament on finding that consensus. And they are work together internationally as well, and because it's the needs of countries coming together and companies changing their ways and methods of production to realise that phase shift that we've defined in this debate. Presiding Officer, COP26 gives us the opportunity of new and international thinking, a chance to show Scotland and the UK at its best and to prove that we're ready to play our part on the international stage. But it's not going to be easy. We need politicians to be constructive, to work together. An event like that is no place for divisive and toxic discourse between governments. The Scottish and UK governments really need to step up. We need to be completely focused on recovery from the pandemic and recovery for the planet. Every delay reduces the chance of our avoiding catastrophic climate change and temperature increase and species loss. Every delay will cause more pain for those countries already living with the impacts of climate change and most at risk of the worst damage. Alex Rowley is absolutely right. We need to get past these well-meaning speeches. Distractions could be fatal. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call on Mark Ruskell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and can I welcome both the Minister and Cabinet Secretary to their new posts, and also many members who've given their first speeches here this afternoon. I was particularly struck by what Mercedes Villalba talked about in relation to the transformative role of the state in actually investing in solutions and the importance of a Green New Deal that involves the unions, that involves the workers in that transition. And I'm looking across to what's happening in the US at the moment with Biden's administration and the absolutely transformative investments in new technology and industries there. Not just fixing markets, but creating new markets. Exciting times. But, you know, I would say to Labour colleagues that if this Parliament had more borrowing powers, if we had powers over electricity regulation, then we could fix things like the unfair transmission charges. But, you know, we're in a consensual debate here this afternoon, so let's hope that, you know, in this year of COP26, that we can strike a new spirit of cooperation with the UK government and that they can understand that Scotland's contribution to climate change and tackling this emergency is absolutely critical. They need to allow us to thrive and our industries to thrive in Scotland. I think it's important that we define what a just transition is a bit. And I miss Claudia Beamish, actually, who would be normally sitting here, because Claudia was absolutely pivotal in getting just transition into legislation in this Parliament, and I miss her work greatly. But it's important that we define this, because it has to be just, yeah? I absolutely get this. It has to be just. Nobody must be left behind. And that's why in the Greens manifesto, we proposed extending that jobs guarantee specifically to workers in the oil and gas industry. And I was struck by the work that Gillian, you know, myself and Gillian Martin have had a lot of conversations about just transition over the last 5 years. I'm struck now by the strong work that she's doing to survey those workers in the Northeast, to actually look at where those skills gaps are. And it's hugely important that we learn the lessons from the 1980s when coal mining communities were absolutely decimated across Scotland. And even in recent years with the closure of Longannet, there was no transition for those 360 workers at Longannet. Everything that was done to secure their employment and future happened after the event rather than involving them in a conversation beforehand. But I would say to Liam Kerr and everyone in this chamber that this has to be a transition. Yeah? It has to be just, but it also has to be a transition. And to move from current resources of oil and gas in the North Sea, estimated at around 5 billion barrels, to then license for 20 billion barrels, is not a transition. Well, it is a transition. It's a transition to four times that level of resource. And that just simply isn't compatible with the Paris Climate Change Agreement. So to answer Mr. Kerr's question about where do you draw the line, about how much time there is left for that oil and gas industry to transition, we have to start with the science of climate. We have to look at what that carbon budget is under the Paris Agreement and work back from there. Mr. Kerr is a lawyer. Surely he understands the importance of international legal agreements. We have to stick with that. And I think there's even signs that the UK government is understanding this now. They're starting to question the policy of maximum economic recovery in their North Sea transition plan. They're starting to turn the corner, not fast enough, but we can get there. And if they do turn that corner, they'll be joining other governments, which are dangerous, Mr. Kerr. You know, Ireland, New Zealand, yeah, they've got Greens in government as well. Denmark, now Europe's largest oil and gas producer. France, are all drawing a line under licensing. They're all moving on. Carbon capture and storage is the wrong priority at this point. Even the Tories on the Eclair Committee agreed that we cannot meet 25% reduction in emissions using CCS. So we have to move on from this. We have to work collaboratively together. We have to test each other's arguments to destruction. But there are some inconvenient truths that need to be addressed, Presiding Officer, and we've just started today in this debate to uncover and examine those. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Sarah Boyack.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Well, I think I would agree with others that this has been an excellent debate. I think our challenge is what comes next in this Parliament, because this is the Parliament that really matters. And I want to welcome the range of excellent briefings from organisations across the environmental movement that we have all had in the run-up to today's debate. And we've also had some excellent meetings, the Nature Champions meeting that we were at, this week's Climate Emergency meeting, where the real focus is to make sure that we have a joined-up approach. So when we tackle our current health crisis, we do so alongside our nature and climate emergencies. And that was argued incredibly powerful yesterday. And as we work to build our recovery from COVID and address our climate crisis, we need both a global and a joined-up approach. And as others said, this year's COP26 in Glasgow gives us an unprecedented opportunity to lead by example and to deliver the success we need for our world's future. And as Fiona Hyslop said, we need to bear collective responsibility. It's up to all of us. So that means leadership nationally and locally across Scotland. And the call in our amendment for climate justice to be included in the curriculum is called for by young people who understand the need for urgency to tackle our climate emergency is vital. By the time we reach 2045, today's secondary school students will be in their 40s. But the tipping point for their lives will actually be action in this term of Parliament. So we need to act. And I am okay about us disagreeing on different issues, as long as we come together on the big issues and as long as we push hard and we push further forward. So in replying to this debate, I'd like to welcome all those new first speeches around the Chamber, but particularly I want to congratulate my colleague Mercedes Villalba on her excellent first speech. She will be a powerful voice for Scottish Labour and for Scotland on environment and biodiversity. And I think it's time that climate and biodiversity is taken seriously across Scotland. In our city, capital city Edinburgh, we saw our draft climate strategy for 2030 published last week. It gives people across our city the chance to give their views on how we reduce our climate emissions. And we need to see plans across Scotland that involve people, that involve communities, that then lead to action on things like low carbon heat networks, on new green jobs being created and tackling fuel poverty at the same time. That's the kind of joined up thinking we need that's promoted by the UN Sustainable Development Goals. If I can pick the issue of heat networks up, Scottish Renewables has identified 46 heat networks across Scotland's seven cities, which following the passage of the new heat networks bill that we passed just a few weeks ago, could help make the much needed progress towards our heat decarbonisation targets. And Section 15 of the Non-Domestic Rates Act, which had my amendment in the bill, gives the Scottish Government the capacity to incentivise investment to enable communities and councils and cooperatives to develop new heat networks, which are currently unaffordable due to high rates. So that's the kind of practical action where we need progress now. Now, the Cabinet Secretary, and I welcome him to his new job and his new team, said that if we get 24,000 jobs, we could create them from action on climate change. But I think the truth is we need to see urgent action, and that needs strong leadership from this Scottish Government, because we can't afford the kind of problems we've seen at BIFAB and companies across the country. Just transition, I thought Gillian Martin's speech was incredibly powerful. It means supporting climate action now and jobs in Scotland now. And that means that the Scottish Government needs to work much harder with the renewable industry to make sure we get a green recovery so that communities impacted by the energy transition are supported to retain their prosperity, to support local communities, to see local apprenticeships, to see training, and to see our communities being able to have cooperative renewable energy schemes right across the country. Now, Scottish Renewables said last week that the renewable energy industry is already supporting over 22,000 jobs. and a significant output of over £5 billion a year in Scotland. But if you pick the stats out, you can see that there's much more scope for new investment in renewables jobs, as Monica Lennon said. That has got to be urgent action for the government. And I would recommend the report produced by the STUC, which actually takes you through what would change the outputs. And there are some key issues where I think the Scottish Government needs to act urgently. So, Mark Ruskell and others have mentioned the updated climate change plan that we need, not waiting several years. We had cross-party agreement from all parties at the end of the last Parliament. So I'd urge the new team in the Scottish Government, pick up on those recommendations and get going on them. Look at the Just Transition Commission. It was closed. It did a fantastic report in March this year. But could we have it restarted so that businesses, trade unions, environmental groups and the government can work together? The report in March was excellent, but it's got to be followed up. It's got to be acted upon. And we need pressure in the Scottish Government, not just in the Parliament, but from those groups outside. Let's see more action in Scottish Government procurement so that we shift to a greener and fairer set of contracts that would be game changers. And the comments made by Maurice Golden about the time for a circular economy, strongly agree with. Let's get the timetable for that bill. Let's get going on it now. Because it's not just that we need to stop incinerating waste. We are still exporting waste to lower income countries who have no choice but to accept our plastic waste. And it's creating a climate crisis in other countries. So we need that responsibility. It needs to be across the parties in this Parliament. We need to move faster, and we need to make sure that our local councils are part of this as well. This is not just a national issue, it's local. So we need to see our councils being able to act on locally owned bus companies, like we have in Lothian, to address the issues Monica Lennon's raised about the loss of bus services. We've got radical targets in Scotland, but if you pull together what everybody said today, we need action. Practical action on the ground, strong leadership and investment to deliver transformational change, and it's got to happen now. So let's work together and make sure the next Parliament doesn't have a lovely debate like this, but that we've made progress and we do it now. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I call on Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be closing this extremely important debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. And can I start by congratulating those who gave their first speeches today, Mercedes Villalba, who impassioned speech. We look forward to hearing more from her through the next 5 years. A really excellent speech, first speech from my colleague Sharon Dowie. I'm delighted she took the opportunity to raise the ongoing issue of Tiboulton Landfill, and also join us, those of us who are continually putting pressure on the Scottish Government to recognise the South West and invest in our infrastructure. Addressing the effects of climate change and taking action to move towards a more sustainable future is one we all share. I think Scotland's aim to reach a net zero by 2045 is certainly ambitious, and it's world-leading. Plenty of MSPs have used that kind of language. It is laudable, and the SNP are never slow to commend themselves for it. But as Liam Kerr pointed out in his speech, announcing the aim to achieve such an ambitious target is one thing, delivering is quite another. And that brings me to an excellent speech by Maurice Golden, that guru of the circular economy, who reminded us that setting targets is not enough and that the Scottish Government have continually missed their targets year on year. I think the Chamber would do a lot worse than to listen to some of his expertise. If we are to succeed in achieving net zero, we cannot allow every debate on the issue to become a competition in political and policy radicalism. Reaching net zero will mean change for us all, but to deliver that change, we must bring society with us, not impose change upon it. I think the Cabinet Secretary agrees with me on that point. Moving Scotland towards a greener, cleaner future should not be seen by anyone as an exercise in martyrdom. Smaller, imperfect steps that we can all take together will do more to get us to net zero than grandiose, impractical gestures that many of the public come to resent or reject. Liam Kerr spoke at length for the need for a just transition from oil and gas. Calls to eliminate oil and gas jobs and create new green jobs are all well and good, but for a majority of people in that work, they won't find themselves suddenly in a green job. I think a point Gillian Martin made very well in her speech. But I would say to her that the potential for jobs within this sector surely must look at the way in Scotland imports much of that infrastructure and that technology rather than utilise our own people. That leads me to education and skills, whether it is eliminating fossil fuel combustion heating systems or phasing out petrol and diesel. We still need qualified heating engineers and mechanics, but are we doing enough to ensure our young people are being trained on today's technology and tomorrow's technology? Furthermore, what opportunities are there for those already in these fields to update their skills? We want all technologies to become obsolete, not the people whose jobs rely on them. Transport is an area where particular conflicts seem to arise. Saying no to new roads is certainly headline-grabbing, but I think it misses the point. It's not roads that impact the climate change so much as the fuel sources of the vehicles on them. We're already committed to moving away from petrol and diesel towards electric vehicles, be that through batteries or hydrogen cell fuel. In South Scotland, we have trunk roads like the A77, A75 and A76, and the rail. All of those need a substantial improvement to support the economy, reduce congestion and improve safety. And yes, they can have a positive impact on the environment. Why are we not investing in these roads with an eye to the future, including infrastructure for fast charging points and hydrogen fuel stations, etc., or developing cycle routes as part of that development? Because reality is that personal private transport can't credibly be replaced by any form of public transport in all circumstances, particularly in rural areas. Air travel. We must encourage the aviation industry to decarbonise, but at the same time, I think we have to avoid denying the opportunity to travel and work and explore the world. Already, the aviation industry is looking at hybrid aviation engines, and that's where we need to be. The fastest change versus the most sustainable for the long term. The objective here isn't just reaching net zero, it's reaching it in a way that's environmentally sustainable and economically viable as well as just. The process of change must be just as sustainable as the outcome. And many of the changes we need to make aren't about changing our daily lives and routines so much as they are about changing the tools and the technology that we use. Now, it wouldn't be a speech from me, Presiding Officer, if I didn't bring the discussion around to health. The health of people and the planet are inextricably linked, and in many cases, efforts to make one healthier benefits the other, whether that be cycle lanes or active travel, or encouraging a more balanced, healthy diet with locally processed and procured food, great availability to access green spaces, warm, well-insulated home. Often a suspicion that the proposals made by some in this chamber around climate change are made as much, if not more, for their ability to drive a particular political agenda as they are for their environmental impact. Business and the private sector are not the enemy. Many companies historically associated with fossil fuel production are leading the way in finding alternative fuel sources. While the Greens might prefer to have the nuclear option to resist our ability to work and travel and restrict private enterprise to innovate, the Scottish Conservatives prefer to work with businesses to support them in reducing their carbon footprint, stress the long-term economic benefits of these green measures. I will give way here.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I just ask, I mean, given that, why did his party take away the market support for the onshore wind industry?
Brian Whittle.
I think a bigger question here is why so much of the wind farm industry is imported into this country? Why are we not doing that on our own? Bifab was supposed to do that. What about Ferguson Marine, who were supposed to be involved in the development of that technology? We import the technology. Why are we not developing our infrastructure and our workforce to deliver that? Economic growth and private investment is what's driven forward the technological innovations that are already helping to make Scotland greener and cleaner. As we look to the future, it's the same kind of private sector-driven innovation and invention that we need to deliver the technology that will help us to reach net zero. We need more of this kind of collaboration. We need to enable and encourage the private sector to invest in this kind of long-term innovation. Big announcements. Grand targets and ambitious goals have their place, but they're irrelevant without a credible, achievable plan to delivery. And all too often, I think the SNP's approach to any challenge facing Scotland, be it climate change, education, the economy or health, is to make announcements that give the impression
the member
of
is,
action
the
without solving the problem. So, Presiding Officer, if I could, we will push for sensible, practical and pragmatic policies that can protect Scotland's environment and move us towards net zero. And we recognise the only credible approach to delivering these aims is through
Whittle.
Policies that benefit our economy and move people's living standards on. Presiding officer.
Thank you. I call on Mary McCallum to wind up the debate. Minister, you have 9 minutes.
Thanks. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As a new member of this Parliament, it's really great to hear the tributes paid to former members who I know would have made a massive contribution today. So, like Sharon Dowie, I want to pay tribute to John Scott, with Monica Lennon and others. I want to pay tribute to Claudia Beamish. And with Fiona Hislop, I want to pay tribute to Rosanna Cunningham, whose contribution to this Parliament, to climate progress, and to my own personal experience in this building has been enormous. I'd also like to thank members from across the Chamber for their input this afternoon and congratulate Sharon Dowie and Mercedes Villalba on their first speech. And while I remember Fiona Hislop, I would love to join you in Linlithgow and indeed to learn from your vast knowledge in this new role that I have been given. So today's contributions, I think, have shown a determination across the Chamber to address the twin crises of climate change and ecological decline and to capture the opportunities of a transition to net zero. But I think, importantly, there's also been a recognition that we are unlikely to achieve any of this without fundamental, transformational, whole system change and without working together, as Sarah Boyack and others so eloquently put. When the First Minister declared a climate emergency and when this Parliament later voted to enshrine the world's most ambitious targets, all underpinned by a just transition commitment, we showed that we understood the risk of inaction. And as the Cabinet Secretary and others have made clear, substantial progress has been made, but we now must go further and faster than ever. And it's incumbent upon all of us to rise to the challenges facing Scotland and the world, because Scotland is watching. And as Claire Adamson pointed out, young people who have driven the cause of climate action, they're watching. And with this in mind, and as I think the Scotland's youngest member of the government currently, I'd ask that everyone across this chamber, in all the work that we do in the years to come, consider the future that we want to leave for future generations. Together, we can tackle climate change, we can restore our natural environment, we can support a green economic recovery, and we can do all of that in a way that promotes greater resilience, especially for climate vulnerable communities. And that green recovery that I mentioned, it is always accompanied by our commitment to just transition and includes our energy sector, just as it does all parts of our economy who will be impacted. Yes, of course.
William Kerr.
Very grateful. Minister, I asked the Cabinet Secretary in a written question when the Scottish Government plans to publish a revised energy strategy. Now, he reiterated his commitment to it but wasn't able to give me a timeline. Is the Minister able to assist?
Minister.
Yes, I think I am. The Scottish Government will publish an updated draft of the strategy next spring. And just to continue with some of Liam Kerr's observations, he sought comments on rail decarbonisation. Scotland's commitment is to decarbonise the rail network by 2035, and that's the only such target in the UK. And on electric vehicles, as the Cabinet Secretary pointed out, Scotland has one of the most developed charging networks in the UK. And to address Alec Rowley's concerns on affordability, we're the only ones in the UK with a loan scheme that facilitates second-hand EVs. On Gillian Martin's well-made point on transmission charges, you're absolutely right. They are anti-competitive, they are unfair. They are the UK's responsibility, and we have been calling on them for years to make
the
difference.
Will the Member take an intervention on that point?
I will.
Maurice Golden.
Thank you. As the Minister will be aware, Tenuous charging works by balancing costs between generators and consumers. Now, clearly, if the SNP are looking for subsidies for multinational energy generation companies, then that means consumers are going to pay more. So, given the SNP's failure to eradicate fuel poverty as promised, then how will increasing consumer bills help?
Minister.
We are not looking for any special treatment, Presiding Officer. We're looking for fairness, and that's what this government's calling for. And on the circular economy, I want to reiterate our commitment to a bill, which was paused because of COVID. But we're also taking action in the meantime, outside of primary legislation, including our pioneering deposit return scheme and banning harmful plastics, including beads and buds, as were mentioned, but also consulting on other harmful plastics, including plates and packaging. I just hope that the UK's Internal Market Act won't hold us back in this environmental progress that we are determined to make, and I think that's something that Maurice Golden should reflect on. And finally, just to reassure Sarah Boyack, we are entirely committed to the Just Transition Commission. In our manifesto, we have pledged to implement their recommendations in full and will maintain the Commission to advise us throughout this Parliament. I mentioned that young people have been central to the climate movement, and like Monica Lennon, I've got huge admiration for the Teach the Future group. The young people in that group are so inspiring, their knowledge is sometimes quite astounding, but we can't allow the burden of this to fall to them. They need more than our admiration, they need action. The group met the Deputy First Minister in September last year and are now engaging with Scottish Government and education agencies to explore how we strengthen learning for sustainability and further embed climate education, albeit that I do have to point out Scotland's curriculum is not prescribed. And it's not just for Scotland's future generations that we need to act, but it is for young people throughout the world that we need to demonstrate leadership. Vulnerable communities at home and overseas are often the first to be affected by climate change and can suffer the most, yet have done little or nothing to cause the problem. That's why in the year of COP26, we're committed to doubling our world-first climate justice fund to help facilitate that much-needed global action. We're also developing the Glasgow Dialogues, where stakeholders from the Global South, as well as Scottish and international organisations, will share experiences and pathways to adjust transition, to adaptation and to resilience. This goes to the heart of our people theme of COP26, through which we are determined to elevate the voices of those who are too infrequently heard, including women, young people and those from the Global South. Ahead of COP26, we're committed to publishing Scotland's contribution to the Paris Agreement, an indicative NDC, which will highlight our actions against world-leading ambition. And that's ambition that is set out in our climate change plan update. And I hear Mark Ruskell's calls to move quickly on a new plan. I share his desire for progress, but I'm sure he'll agree that it must be considered and it must be meaningful progress. We need to work together on that, just as we did work together on the update through the Sustainable Renewal Advisory Group, which representatives of every part of this chamber sat on over many weeks, and we went through all the sectors in the Climate Change Plan update in great detail. And the inclusivity of that board shows clearly the shared responsibility that Fiona Hislop spoke to. Scotland's Climate Assembly is, of course, another key example of that. Another theme that's come through today is the magnitude of the challenge we face on one hand and the scale of opportunity that can be unlocked on the other. Our journey to net zero can deliver for our planet, but it must also deliver for our people. Good green jobs, better air quality and warmer energy efficient homes are just some of the examples of ways that we... I'm sorry, I must make progress, but thanks. And we'll build our economy based on well-being and sustainability for people and planet. And our Young Persons Guarantee is a key example of that and something that I'm very passionate about. We're building on this, and we will also work with schools and employers through our Youth Employment Strategy and developing the Young Workforce Initiative to help ensure a legacy for COP26. This will include identifying climate heroes from industry to support school leaders and young people. Presiding Officer, I have no idea how long I've been talking for because I can't see the clock, so I will close. I open my remarks by looking back, paying tribute to former members and in that way thinking of all that we've already achieved in Scotland's journey. I want to close by looking forward. And again, as Scotland's youngest member of government, by speaking directly to young people throughout Scotland who may be watching today, I don't know. I ask all of them to firstly take heart in the progress we've made, to take note of the commitments that you've heard across the chamber today, and to take time in the years ahead to hold all of us in government and in parliament to account on the contributions that we make now that can help to deliver a fairer and more sustainable future for you and generations to come. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on addressing the climate emergency, and we'll move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of motion 295 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and formally moved.
I believe that Stephen Kerr would like to speak on this motion, and I call Stephen Kerr.
Officer. Today's business motion includes provisions for the week commencing Monday, June 21st, in which time, and not a lot of time either, is set aside to consider the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill. The first notice we received of the Government's intention to lay this bill before Parliament was yesterday, and we were given no details of the contents of the bill other than its name, and the bill itself, of course, is not yet published. It seeks, apparently, according to the Deputy First Minister's statement this afternoon, to extend the immense powers contained within the two Scottish COVID Acts by 6 months from October 2021, with a further 6 month extension option. We do not accept the timetabling that the Government is proposing for this bill. There is no need for it to be rushed through this Parliament in a matter of a few hours. Over the summer, the nature of the pandemic could change significantly. These measures should be dealt with in September, when we will have a much clearer view of what is required. The Government, of course, needs to be able to act in the interest of public health and safety. However, no parliamentarian would want to see any government have such unprecedented powers a moment longer than is necessary. There is no good argument to rush through this power grab within the space of 3 days. Months ahead of its use, without proper parliamentary scrutiny. That is why we on these benches oppose this business motion.
Thank you. I have a request to speak from Neil Bibby. Mr. Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Labour will not oppose the business motion tonight, but in doing so, we still do have some concerns. At present, we don't know the full contents of the Coronavirus Expiry and Extension Bill, and we don't know how many amendments will be brought forward at Stage 2. Given the importance of the legislation, as we know from past experience, that could be a substantial number of amendments, and certainly on these benches we will bring forward a number in areas such as non-evictions. Sufficient time to consider those carefully will therefore be required, and we are not in a position to know how much time and whether that could be done in one day or not. So rather than considering the entire bill in the last week in June, or considering the entire bill in the first week in September, we could hold Stage 1 and Stage 2 in the last week in June and come back and deal with Stage 3 in the first week of September. This could deal with the concerns around timescales and of gaining royal assent, and also allow us to take account of any changes in circumstances that happen over the summer. Presiding Officer, you and other members in the Chamber will be aware there are other opportunities to amend the business for the week beginning the 21st of June. So I reiterate, we will support the business motion tonight, but we seek to raise these issues at the Bureau next week, and I hope the Government and all other parties will give consideration to our reasonable suggestion.
Thank you, and I call on George Adam to respond on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will try to address everyone's point of view while at the same time trying to remain brief, because no doubt everyone is waiting in anticipation for the large number of SSIs that I have to speak on later. At yesterday's Bureau, we had a discussion for a proposed future business. The details we agreed then were that the Scottish Government are introducing the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Bill on the 18th of June and having a stage day by day over 22nd to the 24th of June to maximise the scrutiny time. This is a change from when we did previously with these bills, when they were all done in one day. Stage 1 would be Tuesday the 22nd, Stage 2 would be Wednesday the 23rd, and Stage 3 and Thursday the 24th. I would be quite happy to extend the business day should that be needed, as longer business days prior to recess are not that unusual. Presiding Officer, I cannot agree with Mr Kerr's proposal on behalf of the Conservatives and do not believe he addresses the challenges that we currently face. Mr Kerr's perhaps inexperienced in the matters and how this place works is showing, and it will obviously not be a couple of hours of debate over a day. That is sheer hyperbole and not the reality of the situation. I do, however, appreciate Neil Bibby's contribution and the helpful tone in which he put forward Labour Party's position, but I feel his solution could unintentionally cause further problems. Patrick Harvey at Bureau, on behalf of the Greens, broadly agreed with the Scottish Government's proposals while making his own points on timings.
But, Presiding Officer, there are a number of challenges we face. If we take into account the time needed for royal assent, if the bill is not introduced and passed by the end of June, we run the very serious risk of provisions expiring on the 30th of September and temporary measures which are enabling public authorities to continue to operate in the pandemic falling away. If we do not pass this bill before summer recess, citizens and public authorities will have significantly less time to respond to the changes before they come into effect at the end of September. This bill does not introduce any new provisions. It merely removes temporary measures that are no longer necessary or extends the expiry date to March 2022 to ensure that public bodies can continue to operate while public health measures remain in place. Presiding Officer, I would hope that everyone feels that I have listened to their points of view, but would propose that we continue to agree with what was proposed at Bureau yesterday.
Thank you. The question is that motion 295 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote and there shall be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.